So good afternoon, good morning, good evening, depending on where you are, and welcome. My name is Isabel de Caries. I'm the Chair of Trustees at Moray House Trust and the host for this event. Guyanese Creole, Language and Identity, a conversation with John Rickford. For those joining us for the first time, Moray House Trust is a private, non-partisan, non-profit based in Georgetown, and dedicated to promoting Guyanese culture and public discourse. While we wait for the audience to join, a bit of housekeeping. Please note that the event is being live streamed. If you are on Zoom and would prefer not to be visible, please turn off your video camera. Please keep your setting to mute during the conversation. And if you would like to make a comment or ask a question, afterwards, you will need to join the Zoom meeting for those on the live stream. Details can be found on our website, moreyhousetrust.com. After my brief intro, there will be a short video clip of pre-recorded readings. Then Alim Hosein will engage Professor John Rickford in conversation. After, we will invite questions and comments from the floor. Language is what makes us who we are. Those are not my words. They belong to one of the speakers participating in the University of Guyana's Mother Languages Conference back in February. She went on to equate the loss of a language with the loss of culture. All of the speakers at that conference placed language as a strong marker of identity. Another speaker equated the preservation of our language with the preservation of our culture, our identity, ourselves. Some years before that, Kamal Braffet described the Creole English of the Caribbean as the language of slaves and laborers. Few would argue with that, but let us pause for a minute. Surely, nearly all of us in the Caribbean are descended from slaves and laborers. Guyanese Creole, or Creolese as we usually call it, is not just something that other people speak, it is quite literally in our DNA. Writing a century ago, Graham Cruickshank noted of Anansi stories, "You cannot put an Anansi story on paper, it must be heard." In both African and Indian cultures and among our indigenous peoples, storytelling is both a centuries-old tradition and a living art. We are a nation of storytellers. Raconteurs reign in the rum shops, the schoolyards, on the street corners, and other spaces where people gather. We owe Professor Rickford a huge debt, because what he sets out to do, particularly in the readings that follow, is to remind us that there are many ways to tell a story, and that skilled storytellers can be found in our markets, as well as on our bookshelves, if only we have the ears to hear them. When Professor Rickford was studying at university, it was easy, he writes, to love Chaucer, Shakespeare, Wordsworth, and the celebrated poets and playwrights of English, for almost everyone loved them, and thousands of books had been written extolling them. Loving Black talk, showing why it should be analyzed and cherished, and defending it and its speakers against its many detractors, was, he writes, more challenging. This alludes to the age-old tug of war in cultures such as ours, between what is spoken and what is written. What is spoken is transient. It is also constantly mutating, constantly evolving, constantly being refined. What is written endures, preserved for hundreds of years across time, space, and these days migrating from page to screen. Over time, the language embedded in books acquires a permanence and status that the language spoken on the street seems to lack. This tension is not peculiar to Guyana. or to the Caribbean, though it is complicated by our history as colonies, forever in thrall to the language and culture of the colonizer. What then constitutes a language? Is it vocabulary? Is it grammar? What gives it its status? Is it the existence of permanent written records and examples? Is its status index-linked to the printed word? As the reading from Gray and Cruickshank will show, many Creole words in our lexicon have been in use for at least a century. In fact, our reader, who lives in New Amsterdam, recalls being told as a child that pumpkin was herkina, and confirms that putta-putta is still in use there. Wordsworth McAndrew was one of several who continued Cruickshank's task of collating and transcribing our word gems and expressions such as typee, gege, and typhocious ricketics. His light-hearted index, The Stages of Love, shows that the vernacular is capable of crafting refined categories. Could one conjure a similar list of words in standard English to describe the stages of love? Andrew Bundy, describing the work of Wilson Harris, noted, "A mother tongue coerces its speakers into near insoluble kinships of education, worldview, and inevitably culture. Since the dissolution of empire, it is the English tongue, as opposed to the English rule, that has shaped the peoples of the Commonwealth into shared destiny." End quote. In this, we find both the seeds for the existence of Creolese as a deliberate excursion from the mother tongue and an argument for its acceptance and continuation. Is it a collective attempt by the nation and the region to shrug off what Wilson Harris called the burden of memory? It is among these remnants of Anansi tales, of indigenous myths and folk beliefs that we exchange in the vernacular that Wilson Harris glimpsed the possibility for an entirely new literary art form, a new way of thinking, ultimately a new way of being. Is it possible then that Guyanese Creole is not peripheral to our identity as a people? Is it possible that it is central to our identity? Is it our lingua franca, the most effective medium we have for communicating with each other? A few questions to hold in your mind while you listen to the readings. I'm now going to invite John Agard to say a few words and read one of his poems. Mr. Agard.
Well, thank you very much, Isabel, for your introduction. And it's a great honor and pleasure to share in this celebration of Professor John Rickford, my teenage friend. We went to the two rival schools, Queen's College and St. Stanislaus, but we always connected as friends in the territory of liming, fetting, and adolescent misdemeanors. I wrote an introduction to his memoir, his timely and relevant memoir, as well as multifaceted. And if I may plagiarize myself, I'd just like to read the opening of that introduction, which shows Johnny, age 16. In a special May 1966 independence issue of the Queen's College newspaper, Lictor, a 16-year-old chubby-cheeked editor wrote these words. "While I would not deny the relevance of English and European historical studies, there is everything to say for West Indian, African, or Asian studies being made a part of our A-level courses. Then, even if students fall short of academic perfection, they will at least have some idea of their common heritage. The 16-year-old who made that confidently adolescent yet prescient declaration, bearing in mind the Caribbean Examinations Council had not come into being until 1972, was John Rickford, who went on to pursue a much acclaimed career in sociolinguistics. And I think Johnny, or shall we say Professor Rickford, would also be pleased with the somewhat karmic reality that the poem I'm about to do is on the GCSE syllabus of the British curriculum, along with a poem, Hurricane Hits England by Grace Nichols. The poem Johnny invited me to read is called Half-Caste. Excuse me, standing on one leg, I'm half-caste. Explain yourself what you mean when you say half-caste. You mean when Picasso mixes red and green is a half-caste canvas. Explain yourself what you mean when you say half-caste. You mean when light and shadow mix in the sky is a half-caste weather. Well, in that case, England weather nearly always half-caste. In fact, some of them cloud half-caste till them overcast, so spiteful them don't want the sun to pass aras. Explain yourself what you mean when you say half-caste. You mean when Tchaikovsky sit down at the piano and mix a black key with a white key is a half-caste symphony. Explain yourself what you mean. I'm listening to you with the keen half of my ear. I'm looking at you with the keen half of my eye. And when I'm introduced to you, I'll show you'll understand why I offer half a hand. And when I sleep at night, I close half a eye. Consequently, I dream half a dream. And when moon begin to glow, I half cast human being, cast half a shadow. But you must come back tomorrow with the whole of your eye, and the whole of your ear, and the whole of your mind, and I will tell you the other half of my story. Thank you very much, and congratulations, Johnny.
Thank you very much for that, Mr. Agard. Very enjoyable. Okay, everyone, I'm going to move us straight into the recorded, the pre-recorded readings, which just bear with me and I'll start those. Thank you.
how the African lost his tongue. When one hears a Black man in the West Indies talk English, one asks, what has become of his native tongue? When and why was it dropped? The old books of African voyages tell us a reason. The disintegration of the African dialects began with the slave trade. It was the policy of the slave trader as he went blackbirding on the West Coast and filled the great hold of his ship with its human lading to mix his languages. William Smith, surveyor to the Royal African Company, made a voyage to Guinea in 1726. He notes, the safest way is to trade with different nations on different sides, and having some of every sort on board, there will be the less danger of any plot. Captain John Atkins traded for slaves between Guinea, Brazil, and the West Indies, 1735. His advice is the same. Mix your languages, he says. Remember the Tower of Babel. What stopped the building of Babel? What brought up the brick makers and the masons and stone cutters with a round turn will stop the hatching of plots below hatches. When a cargo is of one language, says the master mariner, caution is so much the more requisite. What began in Africa was continued in the West Indies. The planter took care not to have too many Negroes of one nation on his estate. That a few genuine African words persist. Anansi is the prime figure in the folk tales of the old people. You cannot put Anansi's story on paper. It must be heard. In Wit and Wisdom of West Africa, Burton says, Anansi is a kind of a Rajneda amongst the gay people, a mythic personage generally called Agi Anansi or Father Spider. Bakara, shortened now, except by the very old people, to Bakra, meaning white man, is heard commonly. The word is from the Bantu or semi-Bantu languages of the Cross Bakara River and Western Comoros. Fufu in Demerara is green planting, pounded in a mortar, and eaten with soup, usually okra or kalalu. The fufu, the okra, the kalalu is typical Africa. A jumbi, locally, is a ghost. It takes a brave man to walk near, much more to enter a courtyard at midnight. He may see jumbies. Zombie, in more than one of the West African dialects, is a spirit of the dead. Kalalu has been mentioned. It is a species of Salamnum. The word is African. Possibly some of the plants themselves came westward in the slave ships. Kina is that which, if eaten, or even if come in contact remotely, will result in leprosy or some other skin disease. kina may be lava, or sheep, or bush cow. It may even be a vegetable, such as bitaguma kalulu. Konki was a preparation of cornmeal, flavored with pumpkin, a few currants, sugar, and black pepper, and wrapped hot in a plantain leaf. Krakra is a skin trouble, usually on the head. Puta puta, we still hear of. The old man, wishing to say how muddy the pot is, puts it thus. That pot bad, too bad. Too much puta.
According to Wordsworth, McAndrew, this thing my name love got a bunch of stages. There's 40 of them that he did record. I'm gonna give you 20. Typey. Number one is typey. You got Chirangi. After Chirangi is Chirangi Bang Bang. After Chirangi Bang Bang is Chirangi Look Boop. Then come Toti Lotito Tabanga Ludup Luguomo Diditis Diditis. That's what your senses can't collect. You got logicoma. You want, so you see, so you faint. Frangelangipang. You got giri giri. Behind her is chichiri. Typhocious rickettsics come next. Typhocious rickettsics. Behind her is Kontokyo. Behind the Kontokyo is Gege. Behind her is when Kontokyo more than Gege does bloodshed. See, the Kontokyo is when he watch man and she. The Gege is when she watch man and he. When Kontokyo more than Gege, bloodshed. Bloodshed is almost. You got a gungung jessimi. Gungung jessimi. Haiti pangi. Haiti pangi. Then gung gunga cheche. There's only 20. They got 20 more. I give you 1 to 20. Me know which stage you day.
Under the gaze of the full moon's bloom, the Amazon forest floor gone bust open shabar's plate, creaking, cracking, snapping one curved rib bone at a time, retracting the wilted muscles of Mother Earth's bloom. As the land dwellers at Quibana lay to waste another little fish at their village into the graveyard of babies bloated in stiff hunger. Them little tiny bones of famine get shackled into a crick's biscuit box anchored slowly into the barren earth. While the undead city of Georgetown curses the blessings of Weland with their carbon dioxide, with every step the tech the land crumbles in decay, oozing in an infection of respiratory distress. With just one flick of their finger, The Closelanders recline into the comfort of their icebox, feasting their bulging stomachs on fried chicken in front of flat-screen TV, while the children of Quibana creep in darkness, scratching their graves in hunger. As mankind advances, Georgetown continues the elimination of Mother Earth's heirs. Listen to the buzz of the Coastlanders' electric current. Watch and see how they close their eyes to the black clouds of carbon dioxide melting we atmosphere. Burning fire in we village, in we soil, drying up we rivers. They can't hear the sound of Mother Earth screeches or the final speeches of a dying species because of their desire to plant more seeds of unsustainable power. This global crisis is me village burial. Watch the emissions of Georgetown power plants, admissions into the blazing atmosphere, photosynthesized into the atoms of death. Yet we allow this shadow to burn up we landscape. But yes, Coastlander, it's burn season again, except it's 2 degrees hotter than last year. So it's time for we burn while you recline in front of your icebox. 2 degrees hotter means is heat fever for we children. Tis the season of hunger.
I'm going to read a little bit from the chapter 11 of my book, my memoir, How I Fell in Love with Linguistics and Black Talk. So Black Talk is the title of Geneva Spinnerman's 1994 glossary of African American vernacular English words and phrases. But this is also the title of J. Graham Cruickshank's earlier 1917 book on Guyanese Creole. So I would use it to refer simultaneously to both. Note, however, that while Black talk in Guyana was first created and used by enslaved Africans, it was adopted and adapted by East Indian indentured servants and peoples of other ethnicities thereafter. I will also use the term to include the Creole Englishes of the Caribbean in Jamaica, Trinidad, Barbados, and elsewhere. Now, the late poet and essayist Edward Kamau Brafford coined the term nation language for the Creole English of the Caribbean, the language of slaves and laborers. He said, nation language is a language which is influenced very strongly by the African model, the African aspect of our New World or Caribbean heritage. English it may be in terms of some of its lexical features, but in its contours, its rhythm and its timbre, its sound explosions, it is not English, even though the words, as you hear them, might be English to a greater or lesser degree. Buffett illustrates the point with several examples, including this poem by the late Jamaican dub poet Michael Smith, which, like the sound poems of Jamaican Lyndon Quasey Johnson and other language poets, comes out of the same experience as the music of contemporary popular song, using the same rhythms, the same voice beds, syllable clusters, blue notes, syncopation, and pauses. So let me play Michael Smith reading Me Can't Believe It.
Say me can't believe it. Say me can't believe it. Room them a rent, me apply within. But as me going cockroach, rat and scorpion also come in. One good nose have to run. But me now go to sit up on high wall like Humpy Dumpy. Me, I face my reality. One little boy come blowing on. And me look on him with scorn. As me realize, 7-5 boy Pickley was a victim of the trick. Them call partisan politics and my band, my belly and my ball. And my band, my belly and my ball. Lord, me can't believe it.
Okay, so I first learned to love linguistics at UC Santa Cruz, where I went to school for my undergraduate days. But it's while studying for my PhD at the University of Pennsylvania that I really learned how to love Black talk and how to reveal the complexities and richness of the system. So it was easy to love Chaucer, Shakespeare, Wordsworth, and the celebrated poets and playwrights of English, but almost everyone loved them. And thousands of books have been written extolling them. Loving Black talk, showing why it should be analyzed and cherished, and defending it and its speakers against its many detractors was more challenging. As a linguist, I would write about many subjects, but none more frequently than Black talk, meaning both Creoles, the Caribbean, and African-American vernacular English. So Lebov, my teacher, my main teacher at the University of Pennsylvania, taught me about fieldwork, how to go into the community and record speakers using the language in as natural and informal a setting as possible. Lebov taught me by instruction and example how to combine theoretical and descriptive linguistics with applied concerns of social opportunity and equality. He helped to inspire much of the work I later did on the educational and legal challenges facing speakers of Black talk in the Caribbean and the US. Love is not love if it does nothing to enhance the lives of those we love. So what do I love about Black talk? Let me offer some examples of the lure of this language. So first, I want to share with you a recording I made on the Pusky Island, South Carolina in 1970. The speaker was Deacon Walter Plummy Simmons, normally a subsistence farmer and a dredge worker and the driver of the island's only tractor. He lived in a prayer in a prayer's house one Sunday morning. The full prayer is much longer and it is accompanied by the humming and singing of Deacon's wife, Agnes. But even in this short excerpt, you can appreciate its poetry.
And the gift of God is eternal rest. I'm a father that is slender right now. This world dead man more. They can know a father that the house is on fire.
And all the speakers are
both running down. They can know a father that you is the God and beside you is not. They can know a father that you can defend and you will destroy.
Now, I want you to note the parallelism of Deacon's repeated phrases. Sometimes for inclusion, he got some boys and he got some girls. Other times for contrast. God's thundering in the east is followed by man's thundering in the west, in a feeble attempt to equal him. And I want you to feel the drama of in the central metaphor of the train written by rebellious youth being full of dead man's bones, or the urgency with which the roof is described as not only flame, but burning down. This from a farmer as well as a poet and wordsmith. My next example is from Guyana. The speaker's Anna, a 36-year-old Afro-Guyanese huckster of fruits and vegetables from Buxton, famous as one of the most first villages to be bought by former enslaved persons after emancipation in 1838. Here she is complaining in front of customers and hucksters about the pace of business in Border Market, Georgetown.
Thank God, nothing selling at this market. Every man you got to wait up 3 o'clock long time, thing used to sell. Now it's worse. people they want buy nothing. As I tell them how the price going, they say, thing there, eat there, shopping there, marketing there, all thing there. Nothing at all. Right? Me come out from Boston. Right? Me attack the truth. Nothing at all.
You know, stylistically, we see again, as in Michael Smith's The Poem and Walter Simmons' Prayer, the pervasiveness of repetition for dramatic effect. Not nacelle, thing there, e there. But notice too the variation in grammatical form from the more urban in verb plus in, nothing in selen, to the more rural na verb, not nacelle. So she says not name selling, and she goes also to not na sell. Note as well the deep Creole use of me as a pronoun subject, which occurs throughout Anna's discourse on sluggish market sales, in contrast with the more urban English-like use of I or a as first person pronoun, which occurs elsewhere in the interview, for instance, when Anna's talking about bicycle thefts. This last bicycle I last there, I take it out about 3 months. Finally, note that her plurals are unmarked most of the time in Anna's speech. Thing bad, 3 months. But when needed, they can be marked with English S, as in things, or Creole them, the thing them, or them thing. In short, Anna has a vast arsenal, a wide array of grammatical resources with which to express herself. So my third example is from a 49-year-old East Indian cattle farmer named Lotan, talking about the death of his baby daughter. To introduce the framework for the analysis of the narrative, I need to mention Del Himes, my second major influence at Penn. He was an anthropologist and poet, and was also co-creator of something called ethnopoetics, which argues that narratives are organized into lines and groups of lines based on stress, tone group, and other factors, and tend to constitute sets in terms of a few pattern numbers, commonly 2 and 4. Del's wife, Virginia, had been one of the early exemplars of ethnopoetics, and she helped to organize Lotan's narrative into the line structure shown below. So in Lotan's narrative, the significant pattern is 2. The story has 2 major scenes, the hospital, where Lotan goes to visit his sick daughter, apparently suffering from gastroenteritis, and his home, where his friend Baka comes to tell him in the middle of the night that his child has died. I will focus only on the second half of the narrative, where the two households are contrasted, one belonging to Lotan and his grief-stricken wife, and the home next door, where there's dancing, music, and feasting in preparation for a wedding the next morning.
She didn't say, see when light comes. See when light comes, the light come back. He says, see the light. She said, because of the truth. No music in the piano. Stop, you know?
Now, I want you to note the repetition of propositions and pairs throughout the narrative. You see when light come, see when light come, picky dead for true, picky dead for true. The effect of these is to slow the narrative, letting the individual events and details sink in as they do when tragedy unfolds. This is in contrast to later parts of the narrative, in where the repetition of clauses and the use of introductory wells and contrary devices, like the piling of predicates in the serial verb construction, how we bring the picnicum, and the omission of subject pronouns, are the carfen, are deployed to convey the speed with which arrangements for the burial are executed. Now, people grant that writers have the ability to transform actual or imagined experience into art, but we are less prepared to recognize such strategies by ordinary people in oral narratives, particularly those dealing with personal experience. Note that while the events of the death of Lothan's daughter are drawn from raw experience, that experience is filtered through Lothan's sensibilities and becomes for him, as for other oral narrators, a matter of art. Lothan's verbal craftsmanship is evident not only in the structure of his speech, but in the selection of just the right points of detail for elaboration or omission, as when the neighbors are told simply, "Pickney dead," and the reaction is conveyed in one brief sentence, "Well, the music stopped." So the theme of the story is actually mutual consideration among neighbors and the importance of interpersonal cooperation. The neighbors halt their music as soon as they receive news of the girl's death. Lothan, in turn, hurries to bury his daughter to avoid interrupting the wedding. The proliferation of "you knows" and "you understand" in the last seven sentences of narrative represent insistent appeals to the listener to comprehend why the narrator acted as he did, bearing the child so quickly, and to grasp the larger significance of the narrative. People also contend that vernacular or Creole varieties are sufficient for discussing concrete or everyday matters, but not for engaging philosophical topics like life and death and cooperation among neighbors. This extract clearly shows this to be untrue, as does Granny's lament, which I talked about in an earlier chapter, that the work of a sugarcane reader is so hard that you throw yourself down in the bank and you say, "Lord, when this quarter shall come out of my hand, you better be dead before me I live." For me, as a student of language and society, loving languages or dialects is not enough. We need to also use linguistics to make a positive difference in the world. The above first showed how linguistics could help ensure justice in criminal cases when he succeeded in showing that Paul Pinsvalli, a cargo handler, did not and could not have made recorded bomb threats against Pan American Airlines in Los Angeles in 1987. The crucial evidence was that the bomb threat caller was clearly from Boston, with a long O in bomb and a short O as an off merge, while Pinsvalli was from New York, with long O and short O separate. In the case of speakers of Black talk, the need for positive intervention is especially great because Black people and minorities in general face discrimination in almost every area of life, when encountering police and courts, applying for jobs and apartments, seeking health care, education, and more. And in almost every case, the discrimination is worse when those people speak Black talk. As I will show in chapter 16, the vital testimony of Rachel Jontel, Trayvon Martin's good friend, was disregarded in the 2013 trial of George Zimmerman for Martin's murder because his speech was either not understood by jurors or interpreted as less credible. Over the years, I've contributed to several court cases in which I had to correct the official transcripts of African-American vernacular English speakers. It is striking how inaccurate the police or court transcription can be, apparently done by people with no acquaintance with Black talk. Love is not love if it does nothing to enhance the lives of those we love or the community members who speak the languages we love. Thank you.
Okay, we're going to move on to the conversation section of the evening now, or the afternoon. And I'll just begin with a brief intro. John Russel Rickford, the youngest of 10 children, grew up in Cowan Street, Kingston, and went on to become Emeritus Professor of Linguistics at Stanford University. He's recently published an account of this journey, Speaking My Soul, Race, Life, and Language, copies of which are available at Austin's bookstore in Georgetown. Some of the landmarks include boyhood escapades with neighbors like the poet John Agard and perhaps a few others in the audience tonight, teaching at the University of Guyana from 1974 to 1980, and at Stanford University from 1980 to 2019. He's recently been inducted into America's National Academy of Science. Alim Hosein is a senior lecturer of linguistics at the University of Guyana with a long-standing interest in the mechanics of language and the arts in general. Alim has collaborated previously with Morehouse Trust to discuss the art of Ron Savory and of Philip Moore. Without further ado, I'll hand you over to Alim.
Right, so thank you. Professor, congratulations on your new book. It is a fascinating read and a valuable and useful addition to Guyanese history and culture. I think it's a landmark, being the first autobiography of a linguist, Guyanese linguist. So that makes it a landmark, in my view, a landmark contribution. And of course, the focus on language that is right through the book makes it also different from other kinds of biographies and autobiographies. So thank you very much for undertaking this. The name of the book, of course, makes very clear the importance of language to you, to your life and your career, in particular, the languages we've been discussing, African-American vernacular English, and Guyanese Creole, which are central to the book. And I really enjoyed the extracts that you read and the reading of the stages of Taipei, all of that poetry, which you speak about in the book. I'm fascinated by that, these kinds of things that you call the poetry and the soul of the language. These are languages of ordinary people. So I was wondering whether this poetry and drama that you see, which you don't find in English, if this is because these are the languages of ordinary people, is it this that gives these languages their expressiveness?
Well, I think to some extent, yes, but I also believe that whenever people are using their native vernacular, the language of the ordinary people, to express the deepest thoughts and experiences, they're capable of very deep expressiveness. When I heard Deacon Plummy Simmons talk about the train they're riding on is for the dead man's bones, and listen to the poetry of Michael Smith and the Guyanese Anna Notan in the passage I played this morning, from the perspective of a linguist at least, I heard pure soul, heartfelt eloquence, unrecognized and unappreciated, though it usually is.
Yes, thank you. But even though that may be so, you know, it is true that that might be a revelation to some Guyanese, because there are many Guyanese, Guyanese, who see Guyanese Creole, our language, as being broken and a broken and ungrammatical form of English. What do you say to them? Is Guyanese Creole governed by rules like languages such as English are?
All languages are governed by rules, or else they would not be acquired and they couldn't be used. Let me give an example. For instance, in Guyana, we can use if clauses and prevent me if I get a little technical. I'm trying not to, but you know, I'm a linguist. You can use if clauses without the following then clause. So you can say, if you see the fire, or if you smell the smoke, right? But you may not realize it, but this expression is restricted to verbs denoting the five primary senses, including see, hear, tell, and so on. And they usually require a you subject, and they occur in narratives of past experience. You cannot say, if he see the fire, okay, ungrammatical. And the unexpressed then clause is that you would have been equally astonished as I was when I used that expression, and you would have found it equally worthy to include in your narrative, all right? So these are little things that are part of the structure of the language that we don't think about. Nobody sits you down at the age of five and explains to you that when you use the if clauses without then clauses, this is what you do. All you have to do is grow up in the community learning the phrases before you can begin to understand them. Similarly, a little more complex case, vowel laxing in the vowels of personal pronouns. This sounds very esoteric, but I wrote a whole dissertation on it, and Richard also studied it back in 1958. And he came to almost exactly the same conclusion. So by laxing, I mean, take a word like de. We can say de or de. You could take a word like she. You could say she or she, or you could say me and me, okay? The second one is a laxer variety, which can lead to further reduction and maybe elimination of the entire pronoun. But it turns out that if you look at the frequency with which these things happen, they directly relate to the nature of the preceding consonant. The vowel can be laxed if the consonant is stronger. And that notion of consonantal strength is independently established and validated from studies of many languages around the world. Notice the contrast. You don't normally can't say he for he. Okay, what you can do is you can lose the H altogether. So instead you say he and you say E, okay? So that H is very vulnerable, but the E remains strong and preserves the nature of the vowel. I've looked at this in great detail, recording speakers in Cane Walk, Better Hope, and comparing how frequently they lax these vowels. And it is entirely systematic and it's governed by other rules. You can do it more often with a possessive me. You can more say, eat my book, more than you can say, me went there, right? Or me go there, right? Okay. And so the patterns are very, very pervasive, but you're not aware of them. Okay, I'll try not to go on forever because a linguist gets very excited about this, as you know, Aline, but people
yes,
don't necessarily share my great enjoyment of these facts.
Yes, thank you.
By the way, I must say, en passant, to my friend John Agard, that he's covered a whole other chapter on Johnny and the police, where we spent some time in Albertong police station, but that's another story altogether. Back to you, Aline.
Johnny.
Thank you. Yes, and all of these rules, the ordinary person, the speaker of Guyanese Creole and Afro-American English, they have these rules in their heads. They didn't go to university, they didn't study these rules, but they perform them perfectly, not so?
Absolutely. Yeah.
And,
well, okay, I can go on, but that pretty much answers that. Yeah.
Yes. So it makes you wonder about value judgments and so on about language. So things such as You talk about Creole languages, you talk about vernacular languages, you talk about dialect. Dialect, for some people, you know, the language of the folk. And you as opposed to those, you put up standard language, standard English, standard French, and so on. But really, then, what you're saying is that these labels are just social labels which don't really speak to the value and the quality of all of these languages that we speak.
Yeah. Now, it does not mean that the people who speak them may not want to learn other varieties. And to the extent that they do, I'm all for helping them bridge that gap. You know, one of the first people, Bob LePage, to make this suggestion, was kind of reviled when he said that you can actually help speakers to master standard English by taking the Creole into account, because there are a limited number of differences between the two. And if you do contrastive analysis, you'll be able to move much, much further. But this is not an issue for Lo Tan, I think, where he's living on the quarantine. The point I wanted to make is that people think that somehow, being a cattle farmer, he never thinks about deeper things that the rest of us think about, like life and death. But what he does, and he can express it very powerfully and strongly and eloquently in his language, if we'd only take it more into listen to him and appreciate what he's doing.
Yeah. So how do we give recognition to this vast linguistic talent that people have, and ensure that it is valued and used equally as other languages? And that we recognize that it is a great resource.
Yeah. Well, I think in particular, I'm concerned these days about what effect the speakers of those languages have from using them in contexts where they may not be treated with fairness. I've done most of my applied work, you know, the parts of my book where I talk about love is not love, which, you know, to say you love it without talking about how you can help the speakers of those languages. Most of my work in that area has been African-American English, because this is where I've been for the last 40 plus years. It's devastating to think that people who speak these languages are disregarded, have the testimony ignored. I know this is absolutely the case in America, and I suspect to some extent it's also the case in the Caribbean. In fact, you know, in some other work I've done, you have a transcript of a Jamaican speaker in an English court saying, when we hear the shot, we drop a groan, and then we run. And this is transcribed as, when I heard the shots, I dropped the gun, and then I ran. The man had never said anything about gun. You know, he never dropped the gun. He said, I dropped a groan. I dropped the groan, and then I ran. So how many cases like this might you have in the courts and in other areas of public life? So at least most recent work that I've been doing in America has been working on areas like this.
Yeah.
And I think I would love to see work done in Guyana, in the Caribbean on this, because it's a vast series of problems that might arise, you know, that we are often not aware of.
Yeah. But isn't it also true that languages change, and the Creole language in Guyana and African-American vernacular will also change will also evolve.
Yeah, that's no problem. Language is always changing, but even when it changes, the new system changes with it, and new speakers learn the new system as they grow older. So that's not an argument for not recognizing that it has structure. You know, I should say, by the way, the first chapter of my book, the prologue, talks about my stroke, which I had shortly after I retired. So every now and again, you can hear the effects in some of my speech. Because when you have a stroke, you get many consequences. Luckily, I didn't get any physical consequences, but there's still some effects in how I speak, which is frustrating for linguists because I often know exactly what is different, but you still can't change it. So excuse me.
Okay, that's fine, Professor. We're happy to have you here talking with us. But when you look at things like the 40 stages of type B, which I only knew about one or two of those, Totilotipo, Chirangi, Typhocious, Rikitix. And coincidentally, I have a group of students doing a sociolinguistics course, young people in their 20s and 30s. And I asked them about that, and probably just one of them knew about it. The rest found it quite strange, totally strange.
Yeah, well, you know, Wordsworth was a good friend of mine in Guyana. And, you know, I looked in Allsop's dictionary of Caribbean English usage, and he doesn't have them. He has type E, and he doesn't have the sources. So I don't think people have studied the actual sources of that of those terms. I don't know if Jeanette Allsop, who is with us today, would have anything more to say about this, but I would love to see some analysis of where these came from. You know, he suggested that may be part of the kind of Indic, may have come from Hindi or Bhojpuri, okay. But nobody has really done the analysis to see where they came from. Yeah. And I think, as he would say, you may not know all the stages because maybe you have not been through all the
stages. Yeah. Probably I've been through them, but didn't know I was in Typhocious, Rikitix, or Chirangi, or anything like that.
Exactly.
Yes, it might have helped me if I had known that is what I was going through.
Yeah.
Yeah. But it's interesting. You mentioned the Dictionary of Caribbean English Usage and Professor Alsop. Fundamental work, monumental work. Mm-hmm. But he calls it a Dictionary of Caribbean English Usage. Is there a distinction between Caribbean English Usage and Creole, like Guyanese Creole?
Well, of course.
Would you?
One is the scope, you know. Guyanese Creole is just a Guyana, whereas he's taking into account usage throughout the Caribbean, and very often he would tell you when the equivalent terms in the other varieties. This is actually one of the most valuable resources for me. And Jeanette Allsop, again, has contributed a great deal, concentrating on flora and fauna and so on. And I think that she has done other work since the dictionary came out, which was originally 1996. So it's quite a while ago, but it's still useful, you know.
Yes, and Dr. Alsop is with us here in the audience. So we salute her also. You are also very much deeply concerned about language and social justice, which you touched on in some of the things that you said earlier. And you mentioned Trevor and Martin and Rachel Jante. And of course, here in Guyana, we have the negative perceptions of people who speak Guyanese Creole, bisilectal Creole, and so on. So would you expand a little bit more? Isn't it true that some languages are looked down upon and their speakers are treated as lesser people? And how do we, as a developing nation, which needs all its resources and can't lose the resources of the Creole, again, how do we address this and how do we approach this?
Well,
you have done a lot of work in the United States.
Let me say a bit more about Rachel Jeantel, because I ended up working very closely with her. The important thing is that when Trayvon Martin was killed by Zimmerman, he had an ear witness with him. Unlike a number of previous cases where the case of Emmett Till, for instance, in the 1940s, the people who took him off and killed him and tied his body to a fan and threw him in the river, were found innocent by the jury. And in fact, they went on to write in a magazine the truth of what they did. I mean, incredibly, they told you exactly how they killed him in a magazine, a popular magazine, that was Look. In his case, he had his good friend, Rachel Jeantel, listening to the entire episode until his microphone was knocked from his head and he died about it 1 minute later. So she had a very, very important testimony to give. As it turns out, the jury completely disregarded her testimony, and people made extreme fun of her because of her language. And I wrote together with one of my graduate students, Cherise King, a long paper analyzing this and showing, well, was it partly because of the differences between her speech and the Jewish speech, or was it because of the prejudice against the language? And it was more of the latter. So it's very important if you think that a person who can tell you the truth, I mean, they put you on the stand for 6 hours and basically they never paid any attention to that testimony. There's a book called Suspicion Nation that talks about this in great deal too. And it makes me think about the cases in the Caribbean. I come back at the same kind of point. It does not mean that you have to then take speakers and teach them all to speak standard English for them to do better in court. It means that we have to change our perceptions and our attitudes to what people are saying. So I see the need is more for the non-speakers of the deep Creole and so on to change rather than the speakers themselves. Okay.
Yes, and can you tell us some more about your work in the United States on Ebonics and the use of AAVE in education and the child's native language?
Yeah, you know, this takes us back to the Ebonics controversy of 1986. It always amazed me that people around the country were up in arms against any notion of giving any credence to Ebonics. But they were not up in arms by the fact that, by and large, African-American speakers, especially in deep in the city schools, were doing very badly. So their argument was that, let's leave things as it stands. Right, but the way it stands is not really helping students to do better. And almost all the experiments that have been done, taking the vernacular and doing contrastive analysis had shown that the fact the children were doing much better in mastering the standard language by contrast with the vernacular than had been suggested. In fact, there was a very, very striking story. The Time magazine carried a story about the bridge readers, which did just this. They began in vernacular and they transitioned to standard English and had been very successful in improving the test scores and so on of Black kids. And so you would have thought that the story in Time would have made people happy, delighted. But in contrast, the only message they heard was that they're talking bad dialect in the schools, okay? And the publisher became very concerned and they dropped the experiment. So to me, that is similar to work that's been done on Caribbean students in New York, in Toronto, experimental work showing that you can actually get to the standard more effectively through the vernacular of the students.
Thank you. So yeah, this, it has great implications for us here in Guyana. Some persons, you know, would advocate that in a globalized world, we need to give up our indigenous languages, vernacular languages, and it'd be better for students to learn English and function entirely in English or French or something like that, which could be another long discussion. So there are many, yes, you can, if you wish to comment on that before we wrap up.
You don't have to be monolingual. Many people across the world, and in fact, many people from Africa and many people from India live in communities where they speak many languages. And you're welcome to do that. For instance, why are we learning more Spanish? When I was in high school, language is French. Why? Because Britain is next to France. It makes sense. But here we are in South America, and we were not being taught Spanish. When Spanish was introduced, people may remember from that stage, it had a lower status. So we should all be learning Spanish in South America to speak with our neighbors. But it doesn't seem to bother anybody that we aren't. So people can learn a variety of different languages, and I'm all for that, you know. I should say something in passing, because I see here Michael Mitchell, who I've never actually met, but he provided a detailed critique of my book when it went to Routledge, and so I never saw him before, so I want to thank him for his contributions when it was being written.
And I just say immediately to that, thank you very much as well for letting me read it. It's a wonderful book and I recommend it to everybody. And it's lovely to meet you, even though it's only virtually. I suggested we ought to meet in Georgetown, but this will do for the moment.
For the moment, right. Good.
Thank you. Professor Rickford, it has been an honor and a pleasure talking with you. I wish we had more time to continue the discussion and to touch on other aspects of your life. Your book is about race, life, and language, Speaking My Soul, Race, Life, and Language. But subsequent to our conversation, the floor will be open to the members of the audience to ask their questions from their different perspectives. So, Professor, I thank you very much for producing the book, first of all.
Yeah.
Thank you very much for your answers.
Yes.
I wish to thank Morey House for organizing the forum and inviting me to contribute to it. And thanks also to the audience for their attentiveness.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Alim.
Thank you, Professor. Now back to Isabel. Thank you very much, Isabel.
You're welcome, and thank you. Thank you, Alan. So this is the point where we invite questions from the floor, and I can see there's some veterans amongst us already. So the protocol is you raise your hand on using the Zoom icon, or you can type a question in the chat, or you can simply raise your hand and I will try and find you. Now, we did have a question in the chat that came up. So I'll take that one first and then those in the audience. And the question in the chat is, can someone comment on the use of Creole in some novels, such as A Brief History of Seven Killings by Marlon James, and maybe a few others, maybe Zadie Smith in, or I think White Teeth by Zadie Smith.
So I know both novels, but I have not read them myself. So I can't comment on them. I know Marlon James is a giant in the literary world. And that's set in Jamaica, right? So Jamaica is a very distinctive place in terms of the strength of the Creole and the prevalence of the Creole. I taught there for at least one semester 3 years ago, and it's very, very strong. So it sets an example for the rest of us, I would say.
Thank you. Raymond, was that your question? Raymond with the hand raised?
Yes, that was my question. And I was... when I read those two books, I was pleasantly surprised to hear, to read phrases that I had only heard before.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. Susan, what's your question?
Hi, everybody. Yes, my question was, while listening to Alim Hosein and Professor Rickford have a conversation, it occurred to me when one of them said how a language changes, and how do you see our Caribbean language changing or even gradually becoming lost as a result of the younger generation not even knowing what Totilotipo is and what Taipi is and what Anansi is, as a result probably due to social media and texting and that being now the way of communication. Do you see that influencing our language and probably leading to it becoming not just changing, but being lost in the more recent generation that we have?
Well,
have I made my question clear, or do you want me to?
Oh, yeah.
Have I been understood?
Yeah, but you know, there are always going to be some words that, well, disappear or unknown to speakers. To me, the heart of a language really is in its grammar and its phonology. Words come and go. And as far as I can tell, the Caribbean languages are as strong as ever in terms of the pronunciation and the grammar. Granted, they're evolving in its own ways. But I don't think it's actually changing in the sense of people losing track of the varieties themselves. What you might find, of course, is that the young people are also introducing some new words that we don't know. You know, so when you speak to them or they speak to us, you say, you know, what do you mean by the, you know? So that is true. We're not gonna know all the words in all subs dictionary. You know, I'm not as worried about that, Susan, as I think maybe some people are, because I think it's in the grammar and the phonology that you see the deepest patterns. I hope that comforts you. It may annoy you, but I hope it comforts you.
Actually,
sorry.
Okay, so what you're saying is you're not as concerned as of words being lost, such as to Lotipo or Taipei or Anansi or what have you, the various Obia woman or whatever. You're not as concerned of those words being lost, but it's the grammatical way that we put our sentences together in our phrase, like who said or Miwando or whatever. That will.
And new words.
That is what you're saying, that really makes up the Caribbean language. That is how it is formed. And you don't see that being lost. Yeah. That is of some comfort to me, if that's what you're trying to explain.
I suspect that even when he first wrote it, not everybody knew, not only a dozen, but even five of those terms that McAndrew expressed. Not to say they weren't real, but the rest of the language was vibrant and growing and strong, even though may not have known those particular words. Okay.
Okay, thank you. Salvador. Sal, you're on mute.
Mute.
It's not really a question. What I wanted to talk a little bit about was what I find with the contemporary, the way what's going on at the moment happens in the language. For example, this morning, I got a wonderful example. There was a whole discussion going on in the office, and part of the discussion, I don't know how many of you know, we have a new sculpture on the new road with this eagle. Well, the whole of Georgetown, the discussion on this eagle has been going on now for 3 weeks, 4 weeks since it's been put up, because nobody can agree if it looked like an eagle or a carrion crow. So there was a whole discussion going on about this thing is a carrion crow, but now it has come into the vernacular that the way you describe somebody, and this morning I was hearing it, but look at she dressed up like some carrion crow thinking she's an eagle. So this is what I find fascinating. And also I think we have to a lot of times I hear black Creole. Well, there's black Creole, there's Indian Creole, there's Amerindian Creole, there's everybody Creole. I lived in Rupununi for 6 years and I found all kinds of words that they were using that had different meanings. The word reasonable, when somebody said to you, we had reasonable rain last night, it wasn't reasonable, it was a bloody deluge. The place was underwater, but there was reasonable rain, you know. But this to me is what I find fascinating. And then the other discussions about us losing our Creole, this is nonsense. We will never lose it. It goes on. You might forget the old words, but every day there are new words coming in all the time, and it's constantly changing and constantly evolving. And this whole discussion about not having Creole, I found what was important was to value it. When I was teaching at St. John's, I made them write essays in Creole 1 week and in English the next week. And I corrected the Creole if it was too English, and I corrected the English if it was too Creole, but giving value to both. And I think this is really, really important. This nonsense about us, you know, you can speak both languages, why not? And another example I wanted to just quickly give you, I work in tourism.
Okay, this is the last one.
I had a group of tourists out at Iflucht Estate, and we do a tour with going out in the punts and all of that. And we were out in the cane fields and the cane cutters were cutting. And I was standing there with somebody from Vredenhoop, which is right nearby, an East Indian. Most of the cane cutters at the time were East Indians. And there was a discussion going on between two of the cane cutters, and myself and Kenneth standing there, and I couldn't understand a word. And I'm saying to Kenneth, I said, Kenneth, but what they're saying is, what really going on? I ain't understanding nothing what they're saying. And Kenneth saying, boy, I come from here, and I don't understand nothing either. So not only do you have the geographical differences, but you have the work differences, the what trade you're in, or et cetera. It's so complicated and so fascinating, but yes, that's all I wanted to say.
Thank you. Okay. We just have a long queue.
I second your remarks.
I've slightly lost track of who's next.
Michael is next.
Okay, Michael.
still muted. I really wanted to come back to what Raymond was saying, but I'm very well aware that lots of fingers went up, particularly from the writers. There are so many writers here in this meeting, and quite rightly that they should be saying something, because of course it's down to the writers in particular that the value of Creole and of the rhythms of language and so on has become much more widely known. And this stupid idea that one is superior to the other has of course vanished from any serious discussion of language that you might find in a university, although you still find it sometimes in the popular press. But it's a load of rubbish, of course, because right from the beginning, when the first writers from the Caribbean became known throughout the world because they were published in the metropolis, I mean, Sam Selvan, or there are a whole lot of others, immediately introduced aspects of the spoken vernacular language. And it's obviously it's become much more now, so that you get well, we heard Marlon, heard there of Marlon James, but there are some people who have a lot more extreme language, or you, it even penetrates into all sorts of different genres, like science fiction. If you've read any Nalo Hopkinson, it is extraordinary writing. But not only that, but of course, the whole rhythm and color of the speech. You have to hear a poem read by Derek Walcott, even if it's written in standard English. It is the colors and the rhythms and the pauses and the whole structure of the language is something that is so beautiful that can be immediately recognized by any speaker. So it's a question of code switching as well, isn't it? It's a question of being able to listen to these different codes and to be educated in them. And we're being educated by a lot of the writers here. I mean, John Agard here, he's been doing this now for decades, and Grace Nichols, and I see Stanley, of course, is here, and Pauline Melville and Velma Pollard. There are a whole lot of people who have made it their life's work to do this very practically, and we in schools and universities have been using their work to help people to appreciate what's been coming out of the Caribbean, and particularly out of Guyana. My friend David Dabadeen, of course, in his first poems was using Creole straight away, and in a wonderfully powerful poem that he used. So I would just like to pay tribute to all of those writers. And of course, to Professor Rickford for also pointing this out to people in an academic way. It's totally right. It's great to hear and carry on, everybody. It's marvelous.
Yeah, I think that's true. Particularly, I think an example of August Wilson in America. As he said, when he started to write, he tried to use very high-flown language. The example he gave was, a terror comes over the night like a hawk, something like that. And his plays didn't catch on. Then he started listening to people around him in Pittsburgh and writing down their language, African-American people. And then his plays, as he said, people started speaking and he couldn't shut them up. So if you've seen Fences, if you've seen The Piano Lesson or other works of his, you'll know how rich that language was.
Yeah, I'm based in North America and I have worked in business and so on. And I have found that it is standard English that is totally emphasized. Mm-hmm. And people tend to look down on those who use Creolese. As a matter of fact, when I've worked with other Guyanese, we have used Creolese as it was first evolved from slaves trying to convey message without the knowledge of their masters.
Wow.
We have used this as a sort of code to poke fun of the white people and to communicate more effectively. But it does lead me to my experience to believe that Creole will continue to be Guyanese and it will never gain universal acceptance. On a different note, Isabel, I have been searching for Wordsworth, McAndrew's writing on that, the four stages of love, for a long time. Mm-hmm. And I'd like to suggest that Murray House Trust take this on as a project, make it a publication. I will be the first person to pay a substantial amount for a copy of that publication.
That's very kind, actually. And we owe a little thanks to Rosie McAndrew, who very kindly provided the list. We do hope, funnily enough, to do some further work on Wordsworth's oeuvre, because it is so important. These things must be preserved and handed on. So you will be seeing and hearing more of him, I promise. Thank you. Prof, did you want to make any comments there, or?
No, not really. I agree with Peter on some of his points. I do say that sometimes linguists take the extreme view that people need not learn English or any other languages besides what they speak. And it depends on what the world is like. Going back to the story of Lotan from the quarantine, or Plummy Simmons from the Fusky, I think to some extent, the question of whether they need standard English is kind of irrelevant to their lives, their daily lives. Where it is true that one needs standard English, I believe we should also, as I said before, provide some means of helping speakers to master that, especially students in school and so on and so forth. So I'm not, there's an extreme kind of linguist that says you don't need standard English at all, which I feel would be slightly hypocritical for me to say, because I'm also using standard English to achieve certain ends. So in that sense, I would agree with you. But I think the Creole and the vernacular is vibrant and important in its own way. And to the extent that it serves the needs of speakers, it should be understood and valued and valorized.
Thank you. We're going to move on to the next question. I don't know, is it Tamarand? Have I got that correct?
I don't know.
Tamarand.
Tamarand. Okay.
Yes. Thank you very much. Good afternoon, everyone. Prof, I am happy to be here and I'm happy to see you. It was indeed a great talk. I enjoyed it a lot. My questions, however, I note that you've been using Caribbean Creoles and AAVE collectively as Black Talk. I heard you refer to it as this language, or you may say speakers of Black Talk, suggesting that we're dealing with a single language system. Yeah. Of course, we know they have shared structures and shared histories, etc. But then not all of these languages are mutually intelligible. For example, any speaker of Guyanese Creole or Jamaican or AAVE will tell you it's very difficult for them to understand Suranan, for example. Right, and right. We could counter that by saying, but not all varieties of English are also mutually intelligible, right? But my question really is, what do you think about classifying them all as Black Talk, the possibility of individuals losing their individual identity and also cultural diversity? And following up on Michael and Raymond, I believe, speaking about writing and Caribbean or Creole writers, What do you think about the feasibility of a Black Talk having a common writing system throughout to cover that particular language? Thank you very much, Prof.
Thank you. Well, I did try to qualify the term because you cannot come from Guyana and not acknowledge the other ethnic groups that also use Creolese. So Black Talk was an early characterization of language, but obviously it's been influenced, as I said, by East Indians and all other races of Guyana and elsewhere. In many ways, I prefer Kamal Buffett's term of nation language because it's more flexible for covering a wide range of different varieties. There is a writing system that linguists have come up with that covers many of these varieties. But the problem is that it's so far removed from what regular people write. Like, you know, we would spell cow as K-O-U, you know, ordinary non-linguists say, what the hell is that? You know, K-O-U for cow. But the system is valid because you use one letter for each sound and each sound for one letter. But there's danger because it's too far removed from what ordinary people would understand. So it's not the perfect medium either. Anyway, I think I'll leave it at that and maybe go on to the next, because we have three more speakers to ask the question. So thank you very much.
Joan Cambridge?
Oh yeah. Professor, thank you very much for that talk. I needed it right now. Uh-huh. Because I happen to be privileged to take part in the first ever writing system in Guyanese Creolese at the University of Guyana.
Okay.
Tamarin was one of the people who taught me, Charlene Wilkinson, and Danish Jagannaut was also there. Okay. And I am out of that. I created, I didn't create my character out of that, but I have a character called Bazidi Dolly, the Guyana Rainforest Bag Lady. And she is having a very hard time to be accepted because some of the most surprising people are asking me, what the hell am I doing with this Guyanese, you know, bad English, you know, people slap their children's mouths and say, talk English, you know, they're still doing that. And I wonder if you think that teaching children, because we're lamenting over English results in Caribbean examinations and all of that, if teaching children in schools, primary schools, how the language they're expected to speak to pass their exams relate to the language that they speak with their peers in the schoolyards, in their homes, and all about how what's the relationship between these languages? And there's where the writing system comes in. And I am taken aback by your view of the writing system because I was tutored in the writing system very recently. I'd like your views on that, if you will. Thank you.
Well, it goes back to what I was saying. There is no question that the linguistic, phonetic, or phonemic writing system is more accurate. But who do you want to read it and understand it? Obviously, at some point, we have to get the regular, ordinary, non-linguist person to use it. And so it cannot be a system that is too far away. Now, people may feel differently, but I
But Professor Robinson, sorry, I call you Professor Robinson.
Yeah, it's all right. Professor Rickford. Back to each other.
You know, I am very comfortable with that writing system. And I find that now I'm thinking in that writing system.
Sure.
I find myself becoming very fluent, even sometimes more fluent in that writing system.
That's true.
And I find that it is a system, and I would like to ask Professor Hosein, since he is there now, what is the University of Guyana doing? You know, because I get the sense that the language unit is not sufficiently empowered, you know, to teach that writing system. Should they be? I'm asking you, should they be?
Alim, the ball is in your court.
Yes, thanks. There is a good person who could answer that. That's Charlene Wilkinson, who is the coordinator of that language unit. So Charlene already has her hand up to answer a question, to ask a question. So let me be playing volleyball from Joan to John to Alim to Charlene.
I like the Charlene,
yes, Charlene, go ahead, please. Okay, the
I didn't, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, good. Can I call you later? I'm in the middle of a talk.
Yes, Charlene, go ahead.
Professor Rickford forgot to play a particular quote for you. And a list who said, when asked the question, when is a dialect a language? And the answer was a dialect becomes a language when it has an army and a navy. So Joan, I really hear you and I'm glad for what you have said this today, but I wanted to give some data to, I think it was Peter who said that he doesn't think our languages will be ever accepted internationally. I will say that I have proof and I think I still have the receipt somewhere in my filing cabinet. I earned money recently last year. I think it was sometime early in the pandemic when an East Indian lady living in, I can't remember which state, had a legal case and her lawyer insisted that she have a translator. So we were called all the way in at the University of Guyana to translate for an East Indian lady who had negotiated with her insurance company and her lawyer. I know for sure that in Jamaica, in New York City, Jamaican immigration officers get more money on their salary because they are regarded as being bilingual. So there we are, two international situations where Caribbean Creoles are recognized as real languages. And then recently in the past, I would say in the past 7 years or so, on three different occasions, three different graduate students from doing their PhDs have asked me to certify their use of Guyanese Creole because their departments, one of them was I can't remember which university, forgive me, I get it all. Their departments refused to grant them permission to do research in Guyana unless they had certification that they had enough facility in Guyanese Creole in order to function in the society. So white people accept we language as a real language is we know to accept it. We're not accepted yet. And the children in schools are being hurt because we don't accept it. They're being hurt because their literacy, they're approaching English literacy on one foot only. Yeah. They're not to stand on 2 feet and read and write their own language like white people children. So That's data I'm giving you. I'm not giving you any opinions or anything like that. So writing system is crucial for the acquisition of literacy.
I have no quarrel with any of that. As I think you will understand if you read my book, and we know each other for several years, Charlene. I am a strong believer in the Creole or the vernacular. And in fact, in the case of Richard Jontel, you know, I was saying how important it is to have people who understood the vernacular able to testify in court and to translate for the speakers when necessary. My only question is sometimes about the writing system. I know that the phonemic system is accurate and that it's consistent. And I use it in my own book, Dimensions of a Creole Continuum. But I'm not sure about the extent to which that system could become a popular system for the ordinary people to use.
Thank you. I think we're going to, just to give you the sort of the order now, because we're running a little short of time, or we've run over time a bit. So we're going to take a question from Jeanette Alsop, who's been waiting very patiently for a very long time. And then I think Stanley Graves has a question. And then I'm afraid we're going to try and wrap matters up after that, because we are a bit over our normal time. So Jeanette, please go ahead.
Yes, good evening, everyone. John, as usual, brilliant. And of course, to be expected. We go back a long way, and I remember telling you that I could hardly put your biography down. It was so exciting. But I want to address a couple of things. The first thing is that the tendency to despise Creoles in general and non-standard dialects is really entirely a social one. The Creoles were very creatively constructed by the huge number of different African groups that were brought to the Caribbean, and they had to find a way to communicate with their masters and their enslavers in a very short time. And so we have the emergence of the Creoles, but they have come to be despised because of the people who spoke them. They were associated with the slave population, and it was never admitted because it was really drummed into a by the colonizers, that this was not a good thing, that it was broken, that it was not acceptable, etc., etc. So that's one of the things we have to overcome. And one of the points I want to make is that you cannot get students in school, which would tie in with what Charlene was just saying, and so on. You cannot get students to learn either the standard dialect or variety without going through their first language. That is perfectly valid. And as a teacher trainer, as well as a lexicographer, I know that to be true. I've proved it. I've trained teachers in foreign language for a long time here in Barbados. So I know that is a fact. And the other thing I want to address is the fact that I think Susan expressed reservations about the language disappearing, but I would like to give some hope in that it is being recognized more and more in the Caribbean. And I can talk about Barbados more specifically, but I know Jamaica and Guyana. I don't know as much about Guyana as I once did, but I can tell you that efforts are being made by ministries of culture to preserve the linguistic and the cultural heritage. Right now, I'm in the middle of that. I am one of the cultural knowledge bearers for the Ministry of Culture here in Barbados. And I've had to do a broadcast and a couple of other programs on the preservation of our intangible cultural heritage. So there's work going on. And then there's my own work that I extending and producing out of the Dictionary of Caribbean English Usage, a school edition that Richard and I had decided on years ago, because the DCEU is extremely valuable, but it's also a very linguistically sophisticated piece of work, which many people, including teachers, don't understand. So we had decided a long time ago that there needed to be a school edition. And then I made more or less a deathbed promise to him that I would produce the school edition. And I'm happy to tell you that it is in press, and the first draft is finished. I've just finished proofing the first draft along with a former student of mine who I recommended to UB Press, who is publishing it, to be the proofreader. And that school edition has simplified the whole dictionary. I've more or less rewritten the whole dictionary, and I've done it not as a general dictionary like the DCEU, original DCEU, but as a thematic dictionary, which will cater to students acquiring vocabulary under a number of different topics or themes. And it is also illustrated. So there are efforts being made constantly, and I think people are becoming more conscious of the fact that both the linguistic and therefore the cultural heritage have to be preserved. So I just wanted to make that clear. I can't give you a publication date yet for the school edition, but hopefully it will come out this year, which happens to be the 50th anniversary of lexicography at UWI Cave Hill.
Wow, very good, very good. Thanks, Jeanette.
You're welcome.
Okay, Stanley, I think you had a question.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Good. I don't have a question. I have a big, big problem. One is that I have been reading commentaries on philosophies and all this kind of thing. And then I keep looking in the Caribbean. I'm looking for canons, particularly in aesthetics, which is part of philosophy. I'm not finding any. Now, I remember speaking to a headmaster once, and I'm telling him that we do have a philosophical system in Guyana. And he said, well, what's that? I said, our proverbs are the foundation of a philosophy because they deal with perception and how you structure your thoughts in order to make them understood. And so the proverbs are extremely insightful. And as far as I'm concerned, that is the basis of our philosophy, but it's not taken as such. Now, when I was at the University of Guyana, on two occasions, I tried to get the academic board to establish what principles of philosophy or something like that on board. I made a presentation. I was not listened to because I'm sure it was felt, what the hell Graves know about philosophy? He only knew about painting pictures. Anyway, when I put together a team of Martin Carter, Bill Carr, Joel Benjamin, and Rupert Rupnarayan, and asked them to take the case to the academics board, they were also thrown out. So what did that tell me? I was not working at a real university. That's what it told me.
Ooh.
Yes, as far as I'm concerned, I wasn't.
Because
The first thing is that
no, I do.
Your proverbs says that you have seen something which you have questioned, and therefore you have come up with an answer, which is expressed in your proverb. Now, what is philosophy supposed to do? Not to teach you to question things and to explore things and to put values on them. All my life, I've been looking for a value system in the specific, in the visual arts. There is none. And when people talk about the Caribbean art, I said it does not exist. You have art in the Caribbean, but you do not have Caribbean art because there is no particular canon which informs Caribbean art. And this is why when Anne Wamsie was doing her book, I suggested to her that the name of the book should be Art in the Caribbean, as being more specific and more accurate. But this Creole expressions, as far as I'm concerned, are philosophical. And I remember we have the one that I can use now and leave you, is we say one dirty build down.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when I attended St. Stanislaus and we did French instead of Spanish, we had the thing, you know, petit, petit, l'oiseau fait son nid. little by little, the bird. So I said, there you are. There you are. Perception is the foundation of our human species. How we perceive things and then how we structure our thoughts and our actions based on what we perceive. You know, so our Creole expressions gives us that. It gives us our insights, and therefore that's where we should be looking for our wisdom. You know, thank you very much.
Thank you. I think that's a nice note to end on. I'm going to ask Professor Rickford if he has any closing comments.
Johnny Agard, did you have a question to ask or comment?
Are you hearing me?
Yeah.
Yes, yes.
No, I was intrigued, but tell me if I'm quoting you wrong. I think you said, or because as you know, poets can fracture grammar as part of the creative process. And I think earlier you had said, if you see fire, that's correct Creole grammar. You can't say if he see fire. But suppose a poet, just to be the devil's advocate, suppose within a poem or you created this sentence, if he see fire, he would never throw matchstick at grass. If he see fire, he would never throw a matchstick at grass. Would you say that I'm using the language, I'm taking poetic liberties, or would you say I'm writing bad Creole grammar?
No. That's perfectly fine. The expression I'm talking about is where you use only the if phrase.
Just the if part.
Yeah, you say, if you see fire, if you smell smoke, yeah. If you hear the noise, that's it. Don't say nothing that isn't a then clause that follows. So you're not fracturing the language at all when you put the when you follow it with a then clause like that. It's a different kind of expression than the one I was talking about. You see?
Oh, good. I get you.
I get you. But I know poets can fracture language and many other things. You know, those days when we used to hang out, in addition to being mischievous adolescents, we were all lovers of poetry. And, you know, Brian Chan, John Agard, all the people who were at Expression Magazine. And fracturing the language deliberately was our pleasure. And you've done it better than most. So, again, I would end on thanking you and commending you. And Grace for your work.
And likewise you, Johnny, for your wonderful memoir.
Thank you. Thank you, Isabel.
Well, thank you all very much. It's been a very enjoyable and interesting session. As usual, we end with more questions than we started. I think we've also scratched a few itches here. There seems to be a lot to discuss in this area. I find it fascinating that Creolese seems to be making inroads, if you like, or becoming more more accepted part of the culture in the arts. But some of the interventions that you're describing, Prof, the use of translators, for example, in court cases, which is now obviously accepted in places like America, which maybe we should be considering in Guyana as well. And then also the whole business of where it fits into the education system, which I know is something that Alim and others, and Charlene and others think, you know, very, very carefully about and have very strong feelings about. I love Stanley's suggestion for proverbs and philosophy. So maybe we'll try and go down that road next and see where it leads. But thank you. It's been a very stimulating and enjoyable discussion. And we look forward to seeing you all again soon. So have a good evening or afternoon. Thank you again.
Thank you.
Okay.